Attorney's busy season. Now we're gathered here in church to focus our thoughts and give thanks for the gift that is at the heart of this season. As we prepare to do so, I invite you to take a few deep breaths, let go of those burdens which have been weighing you down, and prepare to open your heart and open your mind, open your spirit to the coming of Christ this night.
May there be a pause tonight in the conflicts of the world, a pause that allows the world to breathe with hope tonight, enough to take a breath and know God has set free a promise that the one made all of light is our salvation, tonight.
May there be longing tonight, deep enough to unite all longing, from Aleppo to our own neighborhood, for peace and truth, that feels God's own longing as the sun falls from heaven tonight into the vulnerable darkness of earth and brings it redemption tonight.
May there be despair tonight in the corridors of darkness, worry at the tables of power, concern round the thrones of despots, whose wisest move tonight is to recognize they can do nothing to stop the joy of the light pouring in through every crack in their universe tonight.
May there be love tonight, fully human and alive, that gives of itself for humanity and offers a child born for us all tonight. A God who takes this personally and bundles into skin the gift of Emmanuel tonight.
The day is here. The time is now. The babe has cried. The light has come. The shepherds in the hills prepare to meet their Savior, Messiah, and Lord. Let us join them in worship.
Come, ye faithful, joyful and triumphant, O come, ye O come, ye to Bethlehem. The Old Testament lesson for tonight comes to us from Psalm 96, verses 7 through 10. Hear now these words from the Word. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord is King. The world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord abides forever. Amen.
Shepherd and rise up, 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 shepherd and rise up,
shepherd and rise up.
Rise up, shepherd, and fall.
invite you to hear the familiar Christmas story from the Gospel of Luke. It is good to hear familiar stories and be comforted by them. I also invite you, though, to listen for a new word that the Lord may have for you this night in this story. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all of these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them. May God richly bless the reading and the hearing of this portion of the scriptures. Amen. This morning in worship, we looked at John's lofty theological praise about what the coming of Christ meant for the world. He wrote, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace." It's magnificent. It's cosmic. It's inspiring. Tonight we listen once again to Dr. Luke's description of the event by which God's eternal word became flesh and came into the world. The good doctor has a special interest in details, in context, in the people and the external factors which affect their lives. Luke's is the beloved version of the Christmas story for these very reasons, and it's our reading every Christmas Eve. In my reading to prepare for preaching on the story once again, I have come across a couple of insights this week that I'd like to focus on. One is about the nature of time, and the other is about the nature of journey. Luke starts out talking about in those days, but he ends up talking about this day. Charles Campbell asserts that this is not accidental and it's not insignificant. He writes, "Luke proclaims the odd, astonishing arrival of a new world, a new time. His story begins in the old time, chronological time, time that's shaped by the powers that be. where the emperor reigns. Time is denoted by who is in power. Quirinius was governor of Syria. And here is the story time in which many people live even today, the time of the census and taxes and authoritative orders and pronouncements, time shaped by business as usual, by the world's accepted power structures, history defined by those in positions of authority. So Luke's story begins in the old time, the old age. In those days, even the words, Campbell writes, sound tired and hopeless. In those days, same old people are in charge. They're fighting the same old fights with each other. They're continually making decisions which cause suffering, inconvenience, and dislocation to people. Journeys are made to get real ID licenses. Overcrowded waiting rooms are filled with men, women, and children hoping to get a work permit or medical attention or a disability certification or a chance for a job. During the census that Luke tells us about, there was a rebellion against it, which was brutally put down by the Roman government. And those kinds of things routinely happened in those days. One of the consequences of the census was that Joseph and Mary had to make an unwelcome journey at an unwelcome time to an unwelcoming town. Well, we're all familiar with making journeys, aren't we? I expect that many of you have made journeys to be in this place this night for Christmas Eve. Some of you are from here and you've returned home to be with family. Others are here specifically to be with someone for Christmas. And you probably have some time-honored Christmas Eve and Christmas Day traditions which are going to bring joy and contentment to your heart. Well, Cynthia Rigby reminds us that this was not the kind of journey that Mary and Joseph took. She writes, "Mary, Joseph, Jesus, and the shepherds do not travel with the anticipation that they will arrive to a familiar, homemade Christmas. They're headed to that which is uncomfortable and utterly new. Mary and Joseph are moving further and further away from their homes as they make the journey to register. Jesus, the Son, has made a journey, leaving his place at the side of his Father. He's gone into the far country of earth in order to be with us, Emmanuel. And the shepherds are minding the business of their own familiar domain when they are compelled by the good news of the angels to travel and to seek." There's so much sentimentality about being home for the holidays and being home for Christmas that I think this is an important insight. Perhaps it is the year when that sentimental picture is absent in our lives that we will most clearly relate to and recognize the importance of what actually happened that night. A soldier in a foxhole in Germany, or the Mekong Delta, or some other theater of war on Christmas Eve. A doctor starting a practice all the way across the country from family and having to staff the emergency room on Christmas Eve. An aid worker answering an urgent request to go to Sri Lanka after a Christmas Day tidal wave. Experiencing a disorienting day in the Atlanta airport during a power outage trying to get home for the holidays. Or trying to find a new place among the old and familiar events of Christmas as a recent widow or widower. These are examples of journeys away from home, away from the familiar, into the unexpected territory of unfamiliar faces crowding around us in some Bethlehem. So Dr. Luke tells the story from the perspective of a doctor who knows intimately how his patient will be affected by having to make such a journey when 9 months pregnant, or having to deal with the rising panic of not being able to find a room for your pregnant wife and going from door to door asking. From giving birth in a space reserved for animals, miles away from the family and the midwife and the hot towels and the neighborly meals that had been in the plan. And instead of placing the newborn baby in the new crib, I'm sure lovingly constructed by his carpenter father, Joseph, placing him instead in a manger, which was a feed trough for animals. And yet, Luke records no whining, no grumbling, no complaining about any of this. Rigby writes, those who assumed that being away from home at Christmas would be unsettling might be surprised that the dislocation of the figures in this story does not appear to destabilize them. Mary and Joseph make a home where there is no home. Jesus nestles in the manger and is nurtured in his parents' arms. The shepherds tell the story of the angels gathered in the dim candlelight of the stable as if they're with old friends. What is right about this is that there is a home whose hearth is Jesus Christ himself. He is the center of Mary and Joseph's life, of the song of the angels, of the mission of the shepherds. Where the Christ child lays, the story tells us, that is where home is. This child is born for all the people. He is our Savior, our Messiah, the one in whom our unsettledness gives way to great joy and peace. And so in this birth, Charles Campbell says, time shifts away from those days to this day. The first words said in the story after the birth of Jesus are said by an angel to terrified shepherds. Do not be afraid. For see, I'm bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, the Messiah, Christ the Lord. And so, an inconvenient journey away from home at Christmas ushered in a new time, God's time. And that's amazingly even reflected in our calendars, in the way we count time. The birth of Jesus was a quiet event, certainly not one that the newspapers would have covered. But it changed the world. For to us was born that day a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift to us, which is what inspires our giving of gifts to others. Amen. Each Christmas Eve, we receive an offering, and the offering is given to a community agency which is working to provide hospitality for people in the situation of Mary and Joseph, who are finding themselves without lodging or food or in need of various things. This year, that offering will be given to local community agency AIM. At this point, we will receive the offering. If you'd like to make a check, please make it out to Central Presbyterian Church. Let us present our offerings to the Lord.
Lord, we remember before you the poor and the hungry of the world this night, and worship you now by sharing what we have with them. Take our gifts and give them wings to bring hope to a weary world through Christ, who commanded us to love one another. In his name we pray. Amen.
Symbolism to the Christmas Eve story, which leads us to this point in our service where we jump forward 33 years and remember the death of Jesus Christ, or remembering the story that Jesus was laid in a manger, which was a feed trough, a place where there was hay for the animals to eat. Many years later, Jesus would say, "I am the bread of life. Take, eat in remembrance of me." So we come to the table tonight remembering the purpose of the birth of Jesus, the purpose of the life of Jesus, and his willingness to give himself for us. Know that there are many gathered here from other churches, other traditions tonight. Many have been on journeys that are spiritual as well as physical. Perhaps you've been away for a while from church, from God. We welcome all of you to participate in communion tonight. Let this be your first step, if you need one, back to the Father, back to the Lord who has given his life for you. We are partaking of communion by intinction tonight, which means we'll invite you to come forward, take a wafer and dip it into the cup and partake of the elements together. Choir will be served first. Balcony, I'll be asking you to come forward while the choir is being served so that you'll be here and ready to be served when they're finished. And then ushers will dismiss you by pews from front to back for the rest of the congregation to be served. You'll find a list of music and hymns in your bulletin, and you're invited to sing those which it is appropriate for you to sing when you're not in the process of taking communion for yourself. So we welcome all of you to the table of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is not this church's table, it is not the Presbyterian church's table, it is the table of the Lord, and you are welcome.
Let us pray. God of mystery and might, we praise and worship you, for you came in silence while all lay sleeping. You enter our world as a child of humble birth. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, born of your handmaid Mary. In his face, we behold your glory, for in his life and in his death is your gift of salvation. By your Spirit, make our hearts burn with thanksgiving, that we may give as we have received. Let our whole lives be gifts of praise to you. God of love and peace, in the gracious name of Jesus Christ, your Son, by the power of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, and upon these your gifts of bread and cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this holy feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Empower us by your Spirit, O God, to be Christ's presence in the world, even as Jesus was God with us. Give us courage to speak his truth, to seek his justice, and to love with his love. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. We pray all of these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, who taught his gathered disciples to pray like this.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night the Lord was betrayed, he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body. It's broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, he took the cup and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This cup is a new covenant, sealed in my blood. shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do too in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of our Lord until he comes again in glory. And indeed, he will. So come, the table has been set and the meal is ready.
Invite those who are serving communion to please come forward. Reminder that the choir will be served in the balcony, and then ushers will dismiss you by pews to come down the center aisle and back to your pews by the outer aisle. If you wish to be served in your pew, please let the usher know that and we'll be happy to do so.
Shed for you.
Just so very late.
for you. And by the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. So by the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Command of the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Shed for you. Blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Nancy, the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Billy, the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. May the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Also, the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Brother, the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Jay, the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Bell, the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Beth, the blood of Christ, which is shed for you. Blood of Christ, which is shed for you.
Has everyone been served that wishes to be served?
Body and blood of Christ, broken and shed.
Let us pray. God, on this night when we gather to celebrate your son's birth, we give you thanks for this opportunity to look forward and remember the purpose for which he came, to give thanks to you that he was willing to give us the most wonderful gift of all, which by giving his life was forgiveness of sins and life eternal spent with you. Thank you for nurturing us at this table and nourishing us at this table. We thank you for nourishing us by the fellowship of one another being here tonight. We ask that in joy shared and handshakes and hugs following the service, you will unite us together and unite us to you. And we ask that you'll lift our hearts on high to you, where we look forward to being reunited with loved ones who have gone before us in your kingdom. Keep us true in our faith and strong in our living, that we may join you then. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
true light which enlightens every person has come into the world in Jesus. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Later in his life, he encouraged us to be the light of the world. So in symbolizing that tonight, we light our candles and go forth into the world to bring a light against the darkness. The choir members will lead us in this. They will light their candles from the Christ candle and then go down and light the person at the end of each pew's candle. And please pass it down your pew with the unlit candle being the one that's tilted, so we'll reduce wax drippage. There are containers in the narthex for you to place the candles in as you leave. We will stand and sing Silent Night as we do this, and the lights will be extinguished as we conclude it. Thank you. this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. So rise up, shepherds, and follow. Carry the light of Christ into the world with you as you go. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King.